Thanks a lot for this kind introduction. It's also a great pleasure that we have this session on immune modulation by hyperthermia, because as we have heard yesterday by Stefan Bodis as his lecture, we have to rethink hyperthermia in the field of multimodal tumor therapies, which include the immunotherapy. And in former times, this was very separated, because like radiotherapy, hyperthermia was regarded as a local treatment with its mode of actions. I will shortly go into it later on. But now it's becoming more and more clear that it can also be an immune modulator. So first of all, I want to thank the whole team. Professor Fiedkau, the head of our department, who was supporting this work since many years, physician, physicists, all the cooperation partners. And I think we can summarize the work of the last year, thanks to all the people, the focused beam and the focused heat to expand. What do we mean by that? Because if we go for classical radiotherapy, you know you want to hit the tumor, you want to achieve a high TCP, tumor control probability, but around you have the normal tissue, you should be aware that the side effects are low. And what is becoming more and more clear, you have the tumor microenvironment. And in this tumor microenvironment, you have the immune system, the immune cells. And you now can imagine they are all here, and they are for sure hit by radiation and also hit by heat besides the tumor. And so the field is getting more and more complex, because you need a systemic view on it, what is getting modulated. So like the radiotherapy, the hyperthermia we apply in our hospital, it's a focused heating, it's no alternative but an additive tumor therapy, and we have a temperature range between 39 and 44 degrees Celsius, which is a therapeutic time of 1 hour. So we want to treat the tumor. The three E's, how a tumor develops, I think they are now more or less clear from the Schreiber and colleagues. You know you have a mutated cell. Normally it's eliminated very fast by the immune system. I think we are all in the equilibrium phase here in the room. We have always coming up some mutated cells, tumor cells. They are in struggle of life with the immune system. And if you have 10 or 100 tumor cells in your body, nobody cares about it. What you see in the clinic is the escape phase, because you have the solid tumor. And please show here at the colors, because every tumor cell in the tumor is different. So it's not a heterogeneous tumor assembly. And you have the immune system. And obviously, this tumor has escaped immune surveillance because it's a tumor. So then we could say, what do we want with immunotherapy or hyperthermia or radiotherapy? You can modify on both sides. Either you modify the tumor again, or you modify the immune system to get anti-tumor immunity. Very briefly summarized, what does radiation make in this kind of scenario? You have induction of reactive oxygen species, DNA damage responses, but you also get stress of the endoplasmatic reticulum, and the work of many groups during the last years has shown that thereby you modify the surface of the tumor cell, and if you have an additional immune therapy, like hyperthermia, I will show data later on it, you got the release of so-called DAMs, damage-associated molecular patterns, which then can activate the immune system. When we talk about an immunogenic radiation dose, one would say, okay, the higher the dose, the more immunogenicity. But there's now work coming up from the DeMario group showing hypofractionated scheme, you got release of DNA in the cytoplasm, and then you got activation of the Seeger-Sting pathway and anti-tumor immunity. However, if the radiation dose is too high, you activate enzymes which again degrade the DNA and you lost the immunogenicity. So this paper is highly discussed because they've shown it in mammary carcinoma tumor models, and this is not true for all tumor entities and not under all settings. But this just should show you in the clinics you have to be really aware, very individual of the patient, which dose is immunogenic and which not. What is clear, if you use a single dose of 2 gray, which is used in standard fractionated radiotherapy, you got an increased immune cell infiltration. So a colleague of mine, Benjamin Frey, summarized this very nicely some years ago in Immunological Reviews. So the classical dose you get in recruitment of immune cells, a higher dose you get immunogenic cancer cell death. If the dose is too high, you have to be aware that you won't lose again the immunogenicity. But how now can hyperthermia come into that play? So this is a very simple model system we have in the lab, but we always, if we perform a hyperthermia in cell culture, we always monitor the temperature, as you see, and most of the experiments are performed between 41 and 42 degrees Celsius. This is what you also want to achieve in the clinics. Just some data on it. You see release of danger signals like HMGB1, a slight release after higher dose of radiation on single hyperthermia. But if you combine it, the two treatment modalities, you have the highest release of the danger signal, HMGB1, meaning combined therapies of radiotherapy with hyperthermia leads to the release of these immune-activating danger signals. This is also true for heat shock proteins. We discussed this also yesterday. On the one side, you want to reduce heat shock protein 70 because it's a chaperone. You might get protection in the cell. But if HSP70 is outside the cell, it's a strong immune activator because it carries tumor antigens to cells of the innate immune system, and then you get activation of adaptive immune system. It has been shown by Gabi Multov since some years ago, irradiation increases surface HSP70, and if you add hyperthermia, it even decreases slightly again, but released HSP70 you only get by combination of radiotherapy with hyperthermia. So again, one very simple hint, if you combine these two treatment modalities, you got a more immunogenic microenvironment. But for sure, you also have to go in vivo systems, what also mentioned yesterday several times by Stefan Bodes in his talk, so that we need better preclinical model systems. There are some under development. I've seen one from Alba at the Estro in Milano. They have an applicator for the mice. We constructed our own applicator. This is an old BSD-15 machine. We got here the microwave applicator. You see here the mouse. And we have a temperature monitoring, and we also perform local irradiation of ectopic tumors, 3 times irradiation, 2 times hyperthermia, to get a situation which might be close to the clinics to really see what is now going on systemically. And I just want to stress, we are always testing the temperatures 39, 41, 44 degrees Celsius, and look for immune cell infiltration into the tumors. And just one important point. Also, at 39 degrees Celsius, you get a high infiltration of immune cells, here of the innate immune system, and also a high infiltration of T cells and more CD8 positive T cells. So we could summarize that higher temperatures, so 41, 44 degrees Celsius, mainly induce immunogenic cancer cell deaths, creating an immune microenvironment, which is very beneficial. But you also need immune cells at the site. And here, 39 degrees Celsius might be very beneficial. So we could say, if you heat a tumor, normally you don't have at all the sites the high temperature. So if you have some temperature profiles inside the tumor, from the immunological point of view, it might even be beneficial. Because the lower, higher temperatures leads to the recruitment of the immune cells, and the higher temperatures create an immune-stimulating microenvironment. We made some experiments also if cells of the innate immune system are really involved in that, natural killer cells. This is a simple assay how to test the immunogenicity of cells. So you treat them outside a mouse, vaccinate the mouse, and then after 1 week, you inject viable cells on the other flank of the mouse. And if you have an immunogenic cell death, then you would say that the viable cells don't grow so good, that you don't get as big tumors. And you see, if you vaccinate with only irradiated cells, you got a tumor growth retardation. It's better when you combine it with hyperthermia, and the best is if you give repetitive hyperthermia, you really can get here nice immunogenic cancer cell deaths. And what was very interesting when you talk about the immune system, it's the timing. So we depleted natural killer cells at the beginning, and you see, the tumor growth is even more retarded, so meaning at the beginning, natural killer cells are not beneficial. But if you deplete them later on in therapy, you get bigger tumors, so meaning at the end of the therapy, you need natural killer cells. And this is at the one, when you then talk to many people, they say, okay, then it has no relevance. But this is the different way to think about it. You always think it's a dynamic process, the immune system, and you really have to know when you design multimodal therapies when to apply which therapy. So meaning at the beginning, you got this immunogenic cancer cell, this you activate dendritic cells and you activate natural killer cells, and we have now hints that in the early phase, they kill the cytotoxic T cells, which are activated against the tumor, and at the later phase, they contribute to tumor cell killing. So meaning they play a prominent role, but it's a very dynamic process. So we can summarize this part. that hyperthermia with 41 degrees Celsius is capable of inducing immunogenic cancer cell death, and natural killer cells play a role in the anti-tumor immune response, but you have to be really aware of the high dynamics of the immune system. But it's not only the immune system. There are many other modes of action of hyperthermia, and for sure you always have to have a joint view on it. You have this impact on DNA repair, on oxygenation, on membrane structure, and so on. But it's all interconnected with the immune modulations. And I say it's interconnected with the immune modulations. Others, and we feel that hyperthermia will get a totally new place when you integrate it now in the current immunotherapies. What are the current immunotherapies? It's the checkpoint inhibitors. You all know, we heard a lot of them yesterday. What are checkpoints? Just very shortly. If you have an antigen-presenting cell, it presents antigens to T cells. You got the first positive signal. And in immunology, you always have to be aware you need at least 2 to 3 signals to get the immune system activated. Because the worst thing in our body is to get autoimmune. So Yehuda Schönfeld, a very prominent immunologist from Israel, he always says, we are all autoimmune and improve otherwise, and he's right. So this is really our daily struggle of life, not to get autoimmune. So that's why the immune system has a lot of checkpoints. So you have the second activation stimulus, and if an immune cell is activated later on with the same receptors, you got a downregulation of the activation. So this is a very physiological thing, and you all know last year there was the Nobel Prize of Medicine for this discovery that you can use this natural immune modulation in the body to foster anti-tumor immunity. And you can imagine if you put away one negative signal, you got a stronger activation. So then in our lab, Anya and Martina were interested whether distinct radiotherapy schemes impact on the expression of checkpoint molecules. And you can see here for glioblastoma that mainly fractionated irradiation leads to a high upregulation of immune suppressive checkpoints like PD-L1. And for melanoma, we have to go in the animal. Combination of radiochemotherapy leads to a high upregulation. So meaning, on the one side, by radiotherapy, you induce immunogenic cancer cell death. We learned this before, tumor cell irradiation, activation of dendritic cells, cytotoxic T cells against the tumor. But at the same time, you have upregulation of immune suppressive molecule, which again shut down the immune response. And this is the big rationale why to combine radiochemotherapy with checkpoint inhibitors. Because if you put away this negative signal, you will have in some an immune activation. And now we can summarize. So you have a tumor, you treat it with distinct radiotherapy protocols, you get immunogenic cancer cell death, but you also got this immune suppressive microenvironment. And hyperthermia also fostered this immune activating microenvironment, but nothing is known, or very few is known about how hyperthermia impacts on these immune suppressive microenvironment. And so that's why other groups, like the Horsman group in Denmark and ourselves and some others, started also now to look what are doing hyperthermia treatments in combination with radiotherapy with these immune checkpoint expressions. And this is also one part of our project we have funded by the Bayerische Forschungsstiftung, where we go from the system planning and then studies. System meaning we have now a lab system with a flow through reactor with a microwave heating, we make simulations of the microwave and then perform the biological experiments going for immunogenic cell death, immune checkpoint expression, and also focus, this is mainly the work of Michael Harder and now on the master thesis of Denise Substitil, what is going on with the immunogenicity of the tumor cells with focus on this immunological synapse. And for further details, you can see the poster outside, please. So, conventional heating versus microwave heating. We heard it yesterday, the main stimulus is the heat. You need the temperature. But for sure, you will have some additional effects by the application of your heat. Because microwaves, at a distinct frequency, do interact with membranes. And this is also one main focus of this project, that on top to analyze the immunogenicity of the tumor cells, to analyze at which range also microwave application might have an impact on it. And this is now with 2.4 gigahertz. These experiments, and you nicely can see that at 44 degrees Celsius, a very high temperature, only the microwave heating does induce necrotic tumor cell death, via the conventional heating just starts to do it. This is excluded that these are hotspots because Michael Mikhailov simulations. So meaning at this higher frequency, you also have effects of the microwaves. If you now look for the timing, we now go back here now to conventional heating. So now just to say, what does the heat? And we look for the release of HSP70. What was very interesting, at all temperatures, 39, 41, and 44 degrees Celsius, you have a very early release of HSP70, 1 hour after the hyperthermia treatment. Then it goes down again, and it only comes up again when you combine it with radiotherapy. So this is you see a very dynamic modulation, and meaning if you want to use or strengthen the immunogenic effects of radiotherapy, you should additionally perform hyperthermia. So this might be one hint that it's beneficial to perform hyperthermia twice a week. Because on day one, you very early create an immunogenicity environment, and then at day five, when you combine it again with radiotherapy, you have again the upregulation of the heat shock proteins. So very dynamic process. Now, the last two slides, I just want to show you our first, also unpublished data. What does hyperthermia alone, or in combination, alone is here, or in combination with radiotherapy, make with these immune checkpoint ligands? And you see, this is a breast cancer cell line. Yeah, it's very, at the one point you say you're disappointed, oh, it's very chaotic, but here, this is the baseline. I think you could summarize. You have a slight immune suppression by all radiotherapy, hyperthermia, and the combined treatments. Because in any situation, you got a slight upregulation of these immune suppressive PD ligand 1 ligand, which is even more pronounced here at the higher temperatures. But if you go further on, if you look for PD ligand 2, this is the other ligand for the PD-1 receptor, you nicely can see that you have this immune suppressive event, particularly after day 3, so here at the beginning of the treatment. Later on, it's again downregulated. So if you design a clinical trial, you would say you should give your antibody very early, concomitantly to the treatments, because there you have the upregulation and you have to put away the immune suppression. And if we now go for an immune stimulatory immune checkpoint, so meaning you this is not a suppressive molecule, but a stimulatory molecule. These are very interesting findings because here only hyperthermia is always the first bar. Combination of radiotherapy plus hyperthermia at all examined temperatures do lead to the upregulation of this stimulatory molecule. And I think we could summarize at this point, if you look at that, you should always consider matrices. So don't focus on one molecule. You need a matrix to see what is going on after the distinct treatments. And we can summarize radiotherapy plus hyperthermia creates immunogenic cell death. It also leads to the upregulation of suppressive molecules, but also to the upregulation of activatory molecules. And this is now the big challenge for the clinics, and we will have some data in the next talk of Michael Harder, how we can get some hints in the periphery, in the peripheral blood of the patients, which immune status is present after distinct treatment, and then put really hyperthermia into a new light, meaning you have these immune activatory things, but we have a lot of questions open, when to integrate it in the radiotherapy, when to integrate it in radioimmunotherapy, but I think this is a quite new field, and we can use hyperthermia in combination with standard treatments, like I was focusing today on radiotherapy, to create an immune stimulatory microenvironment, but we have to be aware that we also have upregulation of suppressive molecules, and this really points towards to combine it additionally with immune checkpoint inhibitors or with addition immune modulators. So this was very shortly an introduction about an update of the immune modulatory effects, and I'm now happy, I think we have some 1-2 minutes to take some questions. Thank you.
Thank you for this excellent overview. I'm sure there will be questions from this auditorium. Please, first here. Mike.
Absolutely. Totally agree, Mark. This is the point. So we need some biomarkers to predict what situation we will have in the individual tumor. So you might perform some ex vivo testing if you have, for example, biopsy material. So like these spheroids you could grow in the lab and to get a hint how the individual tumor would react. But we really additionally need seromarkers, liquid biopsies to follow up what is going on. And thank you that you point this out. If we set up new clinical trials, we always need these translational programs to follow up the patients and to really see what's individually going on. And I think this is also one main point why in some situations hyperthermia does work. In other situations, it does not work. This is also one hint. You need this monitoring. And like in the radiotherapy, it's not a distinct temperature which is best, but you really have to see it in the whole setting.
Second question for this.
Yeah, absolutely. I totally agree. So I just was showing GBM in the model. We screen a lot of tumor cells. But I totally agree. They don't. So you're absolutely right, because in the future, we have to focus on the mechanism, what's going on. And not just say we combine A with B and C. It was the same, for example, when to give, how radiotherapy and immunotherapy should be given together. You might be aware of the PACIFIC trial for stage 3 lung cancer. And there is a study when you give the checkpoint inhibitor within 2 weeks after the last irradiation, the patients respond much, much better in comparison to those which receive it at week 3 or week 4. And then they looked at the mechanism, they see after 3-4 weeks, again, they go down. And then you don't need the antibody. I totally agree. Totally.
Timo?
It's a very, very good point, yeah? Because we have some first data if you compare 2D cultures, for example, with 3D cultures. So they react differently. And I think I totally agree that we should check. The best thing, I think, would to check always in vivo. Then to see, so we have some tumors put out and made some immunohistochemistry to get a hint how the expression is going on there, or you make a tumor cell suspension and then analyze it. And I agree there are differences, and this is just a pre-screening to get a hint if it's a higher or lower upregulation. No. But I think this is also very, very important work to do for the future, absolutely.
We have one question from my side. Currently, everything is tried to be combined with the ultimate aim to eradicate the tumor. So you combine radiotherapy, hypothermia, and possibly checkpoint inhibitors. Is it also possible just to use low doses of radiotherapy to first prime the immune system and to separate this from the from the real tumor eradicative treatment?
Yeah, it's a very good point. We also had the thought for head and neck cancer, just to make a pre-irradiation with 2 times 2 gray and 1 times 3 gray, and then before you make the surgery, and to anyhow boost it, and then I think there will be mechanisms pointing out that it will work. We at least in Germany have the problem with the radiation protection offices, because they say you deliver an additional dose, and it's not proven in a protocol. So we have other, even so the patients afterwards receive 56 gray, yeah, later on. But it's hard to get it now through. It's now at the Bundesamt für Strahlenschutz, BFS in Germany, for evaluation. But I think this concept would be, and there's even the, if you talk with Günter Hemmeling from Heidelberg, and also with people from the States, they even now speculate something like just irradiate parts of the tumor to create like an in situ vaccine, and then give metronomic chemotherapy to boost the immune system. I think there's a lot of things to be proven. The only thing where I have a bit a headache is, who should prove all these factors in clinical trials? So this will be a big problem in the future, really, to perform for all the setting randomized trials. So perhaps also there might be a mind changing, really to go more for a mechanistic based situation in some cases. But as it's always easy to say, as scientists from the clinic, it's hard to perform it outside of the randomized trials.
Yeah. Okay. So now we have to move on, unfortunately. Otherwise, so further questions, please. Then in the lunch.